One of the distinguishing marks of being Catholic is that we hold the authority of the Pope, that he is the supreme pontiff and he's the vicar of Christ on earth. And so the role of the Pope is a large role. And a lot of people have a lot of questions, even a lot of Catholics, who don't know, where did this job come from? You know, is this something that the church created over time? Did it come out of the Middle Ages? Did it come out of the early church? Well, we're going to talk about how it came from Jesus Christ, and then we're going to talk about what the job description of the Pope is, and we're going to learn what is the role of the Pope, and what are the, you know, what's the level of his authority? What is the Pope authoritative about, and what, when he mentions things, is not authoritative? That's what we're going to talk about on tonight's show. In order to talk about the role of the papacy and the Pope, I have a very special guest this evening, and that is Gerhard Cardinal Mueller, who has just recently written a book from CUA Press called The Pope, His Mission and His Task. And Cardinal Mueller was appointed by Pope Benedict XVI as the prefect for the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith, a very important role in the life of the church. And he was the prefect for over 5 years. And so he had worked with two popes, Pope Benedict XVI and Pope Francis. And so we have a tremendous guest to talk about the role of the papacy. So Cardinal Mueller, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you much.
Well, this is a delight. Well, you've personally worked for two popes. Not everybody can say that. There's only a few people who had a direct report to the Pope. And I love in your book on the Pope and his role, you start out with Scripture. You start off with Matthew 16 and Jesus calling Peter, who is going to be the first Pope. So let's just go back to that moment of Jesus with Peter up at Caesarea Philippi. Talk about the origins of this office of the Pope and how Jesus started this position.
Our word Pope in English and is coming out from Greek and Latin, but we can say Father, we say Holy Father, that is the same meaning.
Yeah.
Surely some Protestants are saying we have only one Father in heaven, but it's other reality, divine Father. Our God, but we have also the Father and the families, and the characteristic of this service is not a function of a religious social system, but is a representative of the paternity of God himself, and is also a critic for his person, not to be like a president of a state, or it's not a emperor or a monarch or anything else, but is the first servant minister of the church, and the mission of the church is to bring everybody to God, to the knowledge of God, to the faith, and so to the eternal life. No? And the first Peter is a rock. No?
Yeah, before you go to Peter's rock, I just want to underscore, I love how you talk about Pope sounds like it's a foreign word to most people, and it sounds a bit abstract, but you really make it concrete that it comes from the idea of Papa. The Pope is to be a father. Mm-hmm. And I think people can get, even Protestants can get their minds around the idea of the spirituality of spiritual fatherhood, that the Pope is called to be a spiritual father for the family of God, for the church as the people of God. And so I love that. Already, you're taking this idea of Pope and moving it from an abstraction to a personal role of being a papa to the family. You know, families can be disordered without the papa, the father of the family. And so that's what you're saying. That one of the first things to understand is that the Pope is to be a father.
And therefore, I didn't make the title papacy in an abstract sense, but Pope as a personal relation. No?
Yeah.
But St. Peter has a personal relation to God, but also to the faithful. No? That is we are the religion of where the person is in the center. No? The person, the three persons of the triune God, everybody is created as a person. The person of the second person of the triune God, Jesus Christ, has united the human and divine nature and the highest, most supreme truth we can say about us as human beings, that we are persons called to a personal relationship to God and to the neighbor, to the faithful. We are brotherhood in Jesus Christ, in this personal relations that is most important to overcome also the misunderstanding as if the Christianity was abstract theory of about the world. We need some abstraction in the thinking, but the Christian relation to God is not a theory about anything, but is a personal relationship
with Christ. I love that, Your Eminence. Well, speaking of these relationships, Jesus is going to personally call Peter by name, and then in Matthew 16 and up at Caesarea Philippi, Jesus asked the disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? And you get the first, I like to call it, Gallup poll on Jesus. And you know, some say John the Baptist, some say Jeremiah, Elijah, one of the prophets. But Jesus turns to the disciples and says, well, who do you say that I am? And Peter is going to make that great profession of faith. You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And then Jesus turns and says something about Peter. So it's interesting, Peter says something, makes a declaration about Jesus. Jesus, in turn, gives a declaration about Peter. He says, you know, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I call you, you know, Simon, I'm going to call you Rock. So he names him Rock, Peter. What's the significance of Peter's name with Rock, and at the time right now where he's going to be given the keys of the kingdom, which means the papacy, this papal office?
This is a basic difference between the philosophy, vision of the world, and the revealed faith. The people have different meanings also today. There are people who have a good meaning about Jesus, but they don't believe in him, that Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And the link between this promise to St. Peter and the revelation, self-revelation of Jesus Christ in his relation, his communion to the Father, is that the apostles didn't have another meaning, but they have a faith, a revealed faith. The Father revealed us, it's a revelation, and through the faith, we in the Holy Spirit, we can see that this man, visible man, is the Son of the living God. And the reaction of Jesus was, and based on this belief, but confessed in the profession of this Simon, Jew Simon, with the name Simon, he made him to the rock. Now we are saying Simon Peter as if there's two names, but it is a function, but not in the sense of functionalism, but it's his task to be in this faith and the witness of this faith, testimony of this faith, to be the principle of the unity, in this sense, the rock, not for the personal characteristic. We know in the history that this Simon of Capernaum was not a very strong and steadfast man. He was all the time
he's going to betray Jesus.
Ambitious,
but
what makes him the rock is not his individual human character, no?
Right.
And nobody is able to be as a creature the rock on which Jesus has built his church, my church is saying, but the power of the Holy Spirit, which is working in this vacillating human being, and we all vacillating to and fro.
So you're saying it's not Peter's character or his attributes that make him the rock. It's really his faith in Jesus as the Son of God.
His faith in Jesus, but it's a revealed faith. Mm-hmm. And the Holy Spirit give this person and all his successors, the bishops of Rome, this power, this coming from God. And nobody can say, grace to my power and to my intelligence, we know that Jesus is the Son of God. No, we know it only by the revelation of God, but spoken out in the mouth of the church, of the faithful, and St. Peter is this person who take all together in the unity, a community of believers. So we are not only a big number of believers isolated, but we are members of the same body. Is the church the same temple of the Holy Spirit? And this is meant, but it's very important also. If you look in the church history, there was a relatively good pope and some bad.
I want to get to that in a minute. Mm-hmm. But one more question about, you know, as we get into Acts of the Apostles, mm-hmm. we see Peter leading the 12, and even in the Gospels themselves, mm-hmm. every list of the 12 apostles mm-hmm. always has Peter first.
The head,
right?
Yeah.
He's always at the head, right? And so there's the primacy of Peter is pretty clear mm-hmm. in all four Gospels mm-hmm. and in Acts. He's leading mm-hmm. as they need to replace Judas, mm-hmm. who, because he died, he's one of the 12. It's an office. It's an apostolic office. So they're going to appoint. So Peter casts the lots and chooses the successor for Judas. So we see Peter leading. And yet when we get to something like Galatians chapter 2 of Paul's letter, Paul recounts an incident that happened probably in Acts 15, where he had to confront Peter, where Peter made some mistakes. And so we see, even though Peter's pope, he when he's up in Antioch, and then he's eating with the Gentile converts, and then when some Jews come up, these Judaizers, as Acts 15 describes it, these Jews come up from Jerusalem, who maybe are a little bit more like the Pharisees, and Peter withdraws from eating meals with the Gentiles and follows this older Jewish custom, even though he knows that all food is clean, that God revealed that to him in Acts 10, and that all food's clean now, there's no distinction between Jew and Gentile once they have faith in Jesus. And Peter knows that, but then he doesn't act on that. And so Peter is rebuked by Paul. So Paul is going to correct Peter. And so is that a way we look at, I think a lot of people think, some people might think, well, the pope has to be perfect. He can't make mistakes. And Peter, as the first pope, shows us, and he makes a lot of mistakes. I mean, you know, Jesus makes him pope in Matthew 16, but then he's going to even deny Jesus. You know, and so that's not perfection. That's very fallible. And so talk about this idea of the popes and Peter can make mistakes. I think that's, people have to figure out how you balance that. If you're pope, can you make a mistake?
In his moral life, he can make mistakes, but also in his intellectual life, mm-hmm. he can make mistakes as a single person. Nobody is perfect.
Right. Also,
and Jesus didn't promise the perfectness of anybody,
yeah.
but we are going the way and we can lose the right way, and that is also possible in Dante, in Divina Commedia.
Yes,
he sees also some popes in the hell.
In
no?
hell, right, in that's the, right, Dante
the
depicts.
Poems, but he's yeah. expressing the possibility.
Yeah.
The single popes don't have the guarantee that they will come to the heaven. Also, they need the forgiveness and mm-hmm. The justification only by the grace.
Mm-hmm.
And we have this great author, St. Augustine, and especially St. Thomas and other church fathers who made the comments to the letter to the Galatians, and they accepted all the primacy of the Church of Rome especially St. Thomas, but they didn't be harassed by this second chapter of the Galatians, but they said this is a good example to study what is the real, the true sense of the primacy is what is not. No? St. Peter didn't make a wrong doctrine, absolutely definitive wrong explication and definition of the faith, mm-hmm. but his practical behavior gave mm-hmm. the opportunity, the occasion for deep misunderstanding, for the freedom of everybody in Christ. We don't need the law, but in other sense, we also accept the Ten Commandments, but within the justification by Jesus Christ, also the great difference to those who remained to be in the Jewish religion, spite of being so close, the Jewish and Christian faith. But here we have the difference. And St. Thomas explained this was a great humility of St. Peter to accept this correction.
This correction, yeah.
And also the popes of all the times, they need the correction. Also, great theologian had said, surely the pope, in so far he is speaking with the Holy Spirit, you are Jesus the Christ, the Son of the living God, he cannot fall in an error because this is a revealed faith. But by this personal understanding, he can make mistakes, and therefore he is needed to have the College of the cardinals, of the representatives of the Holy Roman Church, to make check and balances of the limits everybody has, no? And also a bishop in the diocese needs function of correction and looking what was good, what is not good, what can we make better, where are mistakes, where I have to apologize, and in the pastor in the parish needs function of correction, and also in a family, father is always a father, but he has not the guarantee not to make mistakes against his wife or against his children, and therefore the wife can correct the father or the children if they become a little bit older. We have a good father, but in this point is not so good. No?
Right.
And we need the brotherly correction. Yeah. We need everybody until the Pope.
So there's a sense in which Peter kind of represents this idea that there's the primacy of Peter, but that doesn't mean that there's the perfection of Peter.
No,
primacy doesn't mean perfection. I think that's an important distinction that you made. And I think that, you know, Paul correcting Peter and Peter repenting, Peter having to repent even after he betrays Christ is a sign of that. But then you made the other distinction that I want to highlight here, and that is the popes and their moral life and their personal opinions, prudential opinions about politics, economics, they can make mistakes. So this idea that that Vatican I talked about the infallibility of the Pope, and I think there's a lot of confusion about that, because I think people think that that means everything that the Pope says or does has to be infallible, but that's not what Vatican I was saying, was it? Talk about this idea of infallibility. What does that cover for the popes? Because I think there's a lot of confusion.
That's often understood or misunderstood as a opposition against the evident truth that everybody can make mistakes and is not able to know all what is necessary or what is knowable. Absolutely not. And the Church, the fathers of the First Vatican Council was not so stupid to distinguish this normal ideas we have of the fallibility of everybody, that in so far as he speaks in the name of whole the Church with the assistance of the Holy Spirit and the basis of the revelation, he cannot say today Jesus is the Son of God and the next day he's not the Son of God. No? Mm-hmm. Because he has assistance and also councils of the bishops, that also this special assistance that they can fulfill their mission. No? Jesus sent them like the Father sent me, so sent I, and to teach to everybody and all the world what I have taught, what is my doctrine, but they cannot fulfill this task only with their own human possibilities, but the human possibilities are supported by the Holy Spirit. And therefore, in the revelation once and forever realized in Jesus Christ, the same God gave to us, the believers, also the guarantee that we cannot go absolutely away from the revealed faith, but not in other things about this vision of the world after Galilei, or
right, right, not practical things or political things or scientific things.
How many
things.
Stars we have, right, and so on. But it was the distance between sun and moon.
Exactly. No, so this faith, the church,
but it's belonging the Pope's infallibility, for the salvation and the eternal life. No.
Yeah, relates to faith and morals, salvation, official teaching when the Pope officially teaches in union with the bishops of the world. On behalf of Christ, he can't err, which is that kind of infallibility has only been exercised in very limited ways. And so, you know, let me give an example, that you highlight there, the popes oftentimes have made moral mistakes. We know of many, many popes who have committed significant sins.
They were involved too much in the politics, no?
Right, that's oftentimes one of the temptations to be worldly, right?
To make own politics, but the Pope has also a mission, and the Church and all Christians to interfere with the ethical principles in the politics. No? We have also to correct the politicians that they know they have to make politics for the common good and not for their own sake.
Not for their own sake. Well, you know, one of the things that I find very edifying is I look back at church history, you can see many popes who have sinned or made serious mistakes or miscalculations about politics and about advice and things. But even though we have many popes who are sinners, they're all sinners, but some who are serious sinners and fallen away. And maybe, as Dante said, some of these popes don't make it to heaven. That's very possible. But there's no popes that taught official error, heresy. And that to me is very comforting in terms of how God protects the church and guides it. But let's talk about, you talk about what the practical job description of the Pope is. What's the mission and task of the Holy Father? What's his responsibilities? What should the Pope be, what should anybody who's Pope be focused on? And I think you do a good job talking about and delineating the role of the Pope.
I think the main challenge of the popes and the bishops in their diocese and the priests in the parishes and the monks in the monasteries and of the fathers and mothers in the families is not in the church and for the church. First, the climate change or how immigration, illegal or not illegal immigration, but we have to look for that for the human treating of all people. This is another question, but we cannot interfere in the politics between the states. It's not for us, for the church, the first.
Right, so for immigration, we respect the dignity of the human person, but how practically?
In every democracy, there are legitimately different parties. They have the right to look for the power in the democratic, parliamentarian sense. And we cannot say we foster this party and we are against this party if they are democratic parties and within the constitution of the state. But the main challenge is for us secularization and to say that without God no life has sense, that Jesus Christ is only mediator between God and man.
So that first job is back to Peter, professing supernatural faith in
Jesus Christ, to speak about the triune God, the incarnation, the resurrection, that we are not lost in our debt, and that we have a hope, that we don't need drugs and no abuse of the sexuality, and we don't need billions and billions of dollars only for our own sake, to live in the luxury, all absurd. So only what we need is a kingdom of God, no? And all the things we need for our life, but the created things can never fulfill the heart and the longing, the heart for the happiness, eternal happiness of everybody. And therefore, in the secularized world, we have not to make this and this and this and this, but to orient, to give orientation, not our orientation, but the orientation in the name of the living God, who gave in Jesus Christ, his Son, his life for everybody, for us. And so the message of the church is that this innest reality of the creation is love, and not the nihilism or the hate, hatred, we are celebrating all saints, the sanctity, the sainthood of the life, and not Halloween with cladlets and all these cruel things, absurd and things that nothing to do with our human dignity. God has created us with a reason and a heart, no? And therefore we have also to look what is very nice, what is wonderful in the world. We have to open our eyes for all the good things.
Your Eminence, when you came to work in at the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith for Pope Benedict XVI, you know, you had studied as a theologian about Peter and about the history of the Church and the Vatican and the papacy. Now you go, you walk into, you know, you're in the Vatican and you're and you're working for Pope Benedict. How did that make you? What was that experience like for you to get your mind and your heart around this experience of working with a pope that you had studied and heard about, and now you have that personal encounter with Pope Benedict XVI, for example? What was he? What was he like?
I knew him from before. No? I'd been member of the International Theological Commission, and so we here as the head, as a prefect of the same congregation, and as Germans, surely we are 20 years difference, but I read all these writings, these books and so. But before I was bishop, ordinary bishop of the diocese, immediately involved in the pastoral, with other thing, as to say, in an office, and to do theoretical work. I was like a way back more to be a professor in help of the Pope as a theologian of the Pope, but also in this time as prefect, I was invited in so much for pilgrimage, for homilies and talks and so on. Therefore, I was not only closed in a small office with theoretical works.
So you got a chance to experience that.
We must remain also in this situation, also pastors interested in personal relation to people and then their salvation.
When you became the prefect for the Congregation of Faith, did Pope Benedict give you any advice? He had had that job for many years under St. John Paul II. Did he give you any kind of advice or warning or encouragement or what he felt that office needed to, how it needed to be fulfilled?
No, it didn't give me special advice because I was before just several years member of the congregation, not the head of the congregation, but member. I was involved in
the
form of
working. So you had been involved in the workings of the congregation, right?
But only from member to the head of the but no, the absolute strange new field in which I came. No?
Wow. Well, the... if Pope Francis was to call you today and ask for your advice, what would be the first thing what would be the advice you'd give the Pope today for how he is to live out his mission?
Well, a little bit delicate to give the Pope advices publicly. And this book is that enough about this. But for my understanding, the world of today need more than before the public role of the Pope, not only the Catholic Church, surely is belonging to our belief that the Bishop of Rome is the successor of St. Peter, but also for the other Christians, they need also significant figure and person on the level of the globalized world, who is the voice of the Christianity, but also the non-Christians, no, the Muslims, no, have some good contacts with him, speaking about the brotherhood also between those who are not belonging to the same religion. and that we are confronted with the whole the problems of this world today, no? The new third world war between freedom and dictatorship mm-hmm. and totalitarianism, not yeah, only between cool. China and the free world, mm-hmm. but also within the free world, mm-hmm. we have this tendency mm-hmm. of non and anti-Christians, mm-hmm. former Christians, to make a substitution of the religion, of the belief, the personal relation to God, which gives us freedom, with their totalitarian idea of the world, but the only human ideas of the world. They cannot resolve the problems, and all the totalitarian systems in the 19th century had failed, and they ended in a greater catastrophe yeah. and tragedy, as they want to overcome the problems of the human, of yeah. the mankind.
Well, it goes back to what you talk about at the beginning of the book, and that is the profession of Peter, that Jesus is the answer. He's the solution, the only mm-hmm. solution. And I want to thank you for joining us mm-hmm. and for your book, your wonderful book that I want to recommend to everybody. If you're looking for a book to understand the papacy and its role, The Pope, His Mission and His Task by CUA Press, by Cardinal Mueller. And you can get this at Catholic.market. So for a lot of you know that we have that website, Catholic.market, where you can get good Catholic resources. And so we've provided this book there that we're promoting, Cardinal Mueller's book there, because it's a wonderful read. So I encourage you to, if you want to interested in more and learning more about the papacy and the history of the papacy, the Cardinal does a very thorough job walking you through that here. So I recommend that book to you. And I want to thank everybody for watching us and joining us. And Your Eminence, thank you so much for being with us and for your wonderful witness to mm-hmm. the faith.
Really blessing for all our observers.
Well, thank you. Mm-hmm. And we'll look forward to seeing you guys all next week. And may the Lord bless and keep you.